Yeah, thank you very much. It's a great pleasure to be here. And that I'm able to be here is due to the fact that I'm no longer in the council, because in these 15 years when I was working in the council, we have this internal rule that in October and early November, when the report is prepared, we do not give any lectures, we do not go on panels. And so this is the first October where I'm free to speak, and I enjoy this very much. Okay, the topic for the next 20 or 30 minutes is the monetary policy of the ECB since 99, failure or success. And one can also phrase it in this way, Mario Draghi, friend or foe. And at least in Germany, in the last few months of his presidency, the criticism of Mario Draghi by Germans has increased even more. And so I think one climax was this guy here, who is the president of the German Savings Banks Association, who wrote a letter of fury and wut brief to the tabloid Bild. You can see him really, he's really angry here. Maybe he's just heard, I don't know, the policy announcement by the ECB. And he said, whatever you do is wrong, you're throwing more and more money on the markets, you have abolished the interest rates, and you have lent money to indebted countries. You are changing the lives of millions of people in Europe, not to the better, but to the worse. It's impressive. So this is, I think, an important position, the president of Savings Banks Association. And the additional climax was then reached when the Bild-Zeitung tabloid press presented Mario Draghi as Graf Dragicula, especially with this kind of tease. So it was not many people criticized that. This was also very, very astonishing. So when one asks about was the policy good or bad by the ECB, I think, and you mentioned it already, there is a mandate for the ECB. The ECB is not free to choose its targets. There's a clear mandate, and the mandate of the ECB is obvious. It says, well, the main target shall be price stability. This was very much the result of the German insistence, saying if we will ever have a European Central Bank, this European Central Bank shall be committed to price stability and nothing else. So that was the German precondition for all the discussions on monetary union, and here it is in the treaty. And so I think the most obvious way to assess the policy of the ECB is just by this criterion, price stability. So it's quite obvious. And you can see the average inflation rate in the Eurozone since 1992 is 1.7%, lower than the inflation rate of the Bundesbank in its lifetime, which was 2.7%. Interesting to note. Of course, it's easier because the period since 1999 was a period of low inflation, but nevertheless. And it's interesting that in this regard, the German professors criticizing the idea of the ECB in 1992 were completely wrong. So there was a manifesto of German professors in 1992 saying, this ECB will never be able to establish price stability because they simply don't want it. The Southerners do not want price stability. It's only we Germans who like price stability. And so I've put it here only in German. They say a consensus to regard price stability as a priority, as it is traditionally in Germany, is not in Europe as a whole. That's what they said in 1992. And they were completely wrong, which is quite nice. And the interesting thing is, also, the German professors were so wrong with this, they did not learn. Yeah? And so I just have now here this, my colleagues, 1 year ago, in a report that was just presented 1 year ago, and it's hard to believe, it was just 1 year ago. Yeah? And they say there is a danger that the change of course in monetary policy will come too late. Inflation might rise faster, and we could, and so on. The capacity overutilization now arising in the euro area is fueling additional inflationary pressures. That was November 2018. It was not 2000 or something. And I'm very happy that in my minority vote last year, I said all these sentences I do not share. So the learning effect of German professors, of some German, not all, but some German professors is slow. Yeah? And that all, of course, doesn't even provide evidence that we have no inflationary pressures, but there's this quarterly survey of economic forecasters by the ECB, and you can see even for 2025, there's nobody, almost nobody, forecasting any inflationary risks coming from the ECB's monetary policy. Today we had the new survey of professional forecasters, and the long-term inflation forecast is, I think, 1.7%. So this inflation obsession of the Germans, or inflation angst of German economists, is completely unwarranted. But it's interesting, it's just so deeply in the German genes that whatever happens, they still are afraid of inflation. Okay, so this was very rough overview. Say, okay, what matters is the mandate, and if we just look at the mandate and the inflation rate, I think everything was fine. And I think also quantitative easing, if now people say there was no deflation, why did he do the quantitative easing? Well, maybe there was no deflation because he did the quantitative easing. Yeah? So it's also a very strange discussion in Germany. We didn't see any deflation. What did Draghi do? No, it was the other way around. Yeah, he realized in 2014 that there are deflationary risks. Then he conducted quantitative easing, and we had no deflation. So it's just, if you do a vaccination, and in the end he said, I didn't get ill. Was the vaccination really necessary? But that's the logic of some academics in Germany. So what did he do? Anyhow, so then I will just go in a kind of chronological way, with this kind of broad assessment, everything was okay. Doesn't mean that I'm 100% satisfied with what the ECB did. And then like Gennaro, I will go a little bit through the history, and we will see some parallels. And I will start with the first 10 years, 1998 to 2008. So the ECB started operating already in 1998, so they needed some period to prepare. And remarkable things to read is what Jean-Claude Trichet said in June 2008, the euro has been a remarkable success. And it's really a nice read if you're sometimes tired or so. The ECB has written a special report in June 2008 on the first 10 years. It's wonderful. So, but to read, what a great achievement. And if you really go to the very last pages, where, yeah, maybe, but and it's interesting also what he said, Trichet. We have challenges to cope with. Well, so she said there are challenges. Rapid technological progress, globalization, transformation of global finance, population aging. So that's the only problems that he saw. And I think in this ECB presidency made huge mistakes because they simply did not realize all the imbalances that were already there, especially in 2008. Yeah? I think in 2000, so I myself realized for the first time that we have a serious financial crisis, I would say, in the end of July 2007, when IKB Bank broke down. But then at least at that date, everybody should have realized, oh, something's going wrong. And that was June 2008. But no, wonderful, great success. And of course, if you look at the data in the Eurozone, you could have seen these imbalances coming from the divergence of unit labor costs, everybody knows. And these were the data that were available there. That's why I stop here, especially with my charts. It was in 2008 or 7 when you made assessment of the Eurozone, these data were there. You could just have looked at them. Yeah? And it's, of course, amazing how huge current account imbalances in some of the euro area members were there. They're huge. Yeah? It's because we had 20% in Latvia, but still Portugal, Spain, 10%, Greece, 12% current account deficit. So how could anybody believe that this is something that is sustainable? And not even talk about it. Talk about the challenges of the Eurozone, you do not address it. It's unbelievable. Yeah? And so the same thing associated with this is the increase of bank loans in Spain or Ireland. They have increased from January 99 to, again, stop here in 2008, by a factor of 4 in Spain and by a factor of 5 in Ireland. So somehow one should have realized it, saying, okay, maybe something's going wrong. If you talk about the challenges in the Eurozone in 2008, so this is something, I don't know, we could have looked at it. I don't know. So I think there was a complete failure of the whole ECB management in these years to realize these developments and to do something against it timely, and not to wait until you get this kind of explosion or implosion. It's unbelievable. They didn't do anything. They just, let's really read this report. ECB, 10 years of euro, it was published in June 2008. It's a wonderful thing. So then came the next phase. Then came the financial crisis. So what did the ECB do? And that's also impressive. And it's really nice to compare the ECB with the Fed. Yeah? And so these are the short-term interest rates, the rates that are directly under the control of the central bank. What did the Fed do? Well, in July 2007, they realized, oh, there's a problem. Yeah? And they got the interest rates down relatively fast. Yeah? So what did the ECB do? No, they saw inflationary pressures, problems. They didn't see anything from the financial crisis. The ECB increased interest rates in July 2008. And at the same time, you could see what the Fed was doing. Yeah? So maybe they should have somehow something that the ECB guys might have asked themselves, why is the Fed lowering interest rates while we at the same time are increasing interest rates? Unbelievable. And then comes the crisis, and then the interesting, this blue line increases until 10th of October 2008. So about 3 weeks after Lehman, this blue line went up. Can you imagine this? It's unbelievable. Yeah? So at least with Lehman in September 2008, one should have realized, oh, there's a crisis. What did the ECB? They did nothing. They allowed short-term interest rates to go up. And in this regard, one can say this central bank has actively destabilized the Eurozone. Instead of helping, see what the Fed was doing at the same time. Yeah? They allowed interest rates to go up. And then, I think October 10 or 15, they said, oh, we have to change our money market policy. We have to do a full allotment and we have to change it. But it took them 2 or 3 weeks to realize it in the middle of a huge crisis. Hard to believe. Yeah? And then you can see how long it took the ECB to get the short-term rate down to the US levels. Again, you can also see from this fluctuation, spikes in the short-term rates, and obviously the monetary management was also not perfect. Why do you need these spikes? Completely unnecessary. You can see, if you go to the end, these spikes are no longer needed. Under Draghi's regime, the spikes have gone. So if you have a weak financial system, banks with troubles, why do you need these spikes? Completely, you see, with the Fed, you don't need it. It's not a problem at all to keep your short-term rates stable. But then, that's not enough. Then you come to, comes the year 2011, yeah. And in 2011 we had already the euro crisis, yeah. In addition to the financial, you had Greece. You could see there was the second was Ireland, I think, and then came Portugal. Yeah. So we had Greece and Ireland already in crisis. What did the ECB do? They raised interest rates. The blue line goes up. Can you believe that? And again, you can see, I think that's normally we don't have the counterfactual as economists, but you can say more or less what the Fed do could be a kind of counterfactual. So the situation was not that difficult, not that different, even though the economic situation was even a little bit better at the time in the US. So you can take as a counterfactual, you can say, well, this is a way one could have also done it. Yeah? No, ECB raised interest rates. And so it's in my view, just amazing, to say this at least, that 2 weeks ago, people who were in charge at that time for monetary policy were criticizing Mario Draghi. It's unbelievable. Yeah, of course, one can say, well, you can make mistakes. We all make mistakes. But then one should be very humble if one has made such mistakes and not get out and say, hey, Mario Draghi, what are you doing? Of course, Mario Draghi at that time was also in charge. He, I think, was the president of the Italian Central Bank at that time. He was also in charge of this. But he's not criticizing himself, at least. So, and then the same, another thing, if you're talking about quantitative easing, again, you can see when the crisis started, the Federal Reserve immediately started with quantitative easing, increased its bond holdings. And the ECB took them until 2015. Until they started. Why did they not start with quantitative easing in 2008? Is there any reason for that? I don't know. Yeah. Maybe they were afraid of the Germans, but in the end, it was possible. Yeah. So I think that's really something. If one talks about the economic developments of the Eurozone, and you've showed it, it's not only fiscal policy. It's really monetary policy. I think fiscal policy was a challenge because, of course, these individual countries had problems to have higher deficits. They were under pressure of the markets. But monetary policy at least could have helped them, given the difficulty that you don't have a unified bond market, they don't have a strong federal government like this. So the need for monetary policy to accommodate and to stabilize it would have been even greater. Instead, they destabilized it. So, and you can see it here a little bit also if you took at the long-term bond yields. So kind of the blue line is a kind of synthetic euro area bond yield. And of course, it increased in the crisis where in the United States it went down. And taking all this together, it's not surprising that the Eurozone ended up in a second recession in 2012, which was completely unnecessary, I would say. Yeah. It was completely, completely unnecessary. And of course, the special fiscal constraints of the Eurozone play a role, but I think also monetary policy did a lot to make this the fiscal management much more difficult. Yeah. Anyhow, so then comes the savior. So I must say, we would have realized it. I'm the only Draghi fan in Germany. So maybe I don't know, you don't get somehow biased view from me, but that's how it is. And of course, with his whatever it takes, he helped to get the risk premium down and change situation overnight. And in retrospect, I think that's a fascinating task because at that time he did not buy any bonds. It was just worse. Just say, believe me, it will be enough. He did not go say, I buy, I don't know, 100 billions. Just say, believe me, it will be enough. And that shows, of course, how chaotic and irrational markets are. Just somebody coming, say, look, guys, you are crazy. And they say, oh, yes, true, he's right. No, okay, let's forget about it. It wasn't that serious. And so that's also one of the remarkable achievements of Draghi, that he just shifted the sentiments of the markets. And I think that was a real achievement. So, what then happened under now the more supportive monetary regime, fiscal policy became more breathing space. So austerity was stopped since 2014. No more fiscal austerity took place. You can see the bars, if they go downward, it means a restrictive policy stance. It means that the fiscal deficit, that the structural deficit is reduced. Yeah. So if it goes down, it's restrictive. And you can see from 2014 on, there are no significant bars any longer. So overall, the structural deficits in the Eurozone remain constant, and even deficits even increase a little bit. So since 2014, you can say no more austerity, with the exception of Greece. Poor guys, because they could not do it by themselves, so they were under the Troika regime, but all other countries stopped more or less consolidating. So Spain is an example, but very long had relatively high deficits for quite some time, and also, well, even France has not 3%, so nobody, since this fiscal compact, nobody's taking it serious. Thank God, nobody speaks about it. So I don't see any Eurozone country that is actively now trying to get to balance budget. They talk about it, say, yes, it's important, but so there's also, I would say, some kind of silent paradigm change that everybody says, yes, we want it, but de facto, not very much is happening, and I think the result is obvious. Now, of course, growth came back, unemployment rate came down, and so far, things look good. Of course, we are now facing a lot of challenges, and I'm not sure whether this positive performance will continue. Anyhow, so, but still, you could say, well, what he did is good, but the side effects, they were terrible. This is what this Draghi is doing to financial markets and the German savers. And then one could ask, is it worth it? And again, I quote my dear friends from my council, must be German Council of Economic Experts, should be too easy. And in 2015-16, they wrote, monetary policy is leading to a build-up of risk to financial stability, which could pave the way for a new financial crisis. In 2016, they wrote, in light of macroeconomic developments, the low interest rates are neither appropriate for the euro nor for Germany, it should say. Interestingly, then we have also some kind of counterfactual in this report where they say monetary policy is not appropriate neither for Germany nor for the euro area. CPR made a survey among economists in Europe, and the majority of these European economists disagreed with the council, which was quite nice because I also disagreed, but normally I'm alone, and so I got this support by CPR, asked, do you agree? And I think almost all economists say we disagree with this statement. So, but the question is, well, are there financial risks for the financial system? Because you could say, well, now he has done stabilized the economy, but the financial system is in dire straits. I would say no. If you look at bank loans to the private sector, which now continues the chart that I stopped in 2008, you can see no problem. Bank loan growth is very, very moderate, 4%, some countries not even less. So we don't see any excessive bank lending in the Eurozone. So we do not see that what has happened in 2003, 4, 5 is somehow repeating. It's not the case. Bank lending is relatively weak. Well, in many countries, banks have lots of problems. They don't have enough capital, so bank lending is not a problem. House prices, people say, well, now Germany, we have huge price increases in the housing sector. If you look at a longer-term perspective, real house prices in Germany are very low. It doesn't mean that, of course, it doesn't mean that in some areas we have strong increase in house prices, but here in Berlin, you must also say that house prices were excessively low. 10 years ago, here in the center of Berlin, you could buy an apartment for 1,000 euros per square meter, which is now a price of 5,000 or 6,000. So Berlin was really an exception, and I think the Senate at that time missed a huge opportunity to turn renters into house owners. That would have been a huge opportunity at these very low prices, 1,000 euros, if you could, with a little help, most people would have been able to buy them a house, an apartment. Yeah. 1,000 euros makes 100,000 euros for a 100 square meter apartment. Quite cheap. And so, government at that time, Berlin government at that time did nothing. And of course, all investors from the rest of the world say, oh, how cheap, from Scandinavian countries, wherever, they saw over 1,000 euros per square meter in Berlin. That's really cheap. And so that's what many people did. But that was a failure, I would say, also of the Senate to use this. Okay, so we don't see any risks of a house price bubble in Germany. Then there comes the story with the German saver. People say, well, the poor German saver is not getting a fair reward for his savings. And fortunately, the Bundesbank has statistics with real interest rates on classical savings accounts. And you see that the real interest rates, of course, were suffering always from very high inflation rates. And so if you take the average for the real interest rate from 1967 to 1998, the Bundesbank time, the real interest rate for the German saver was minus 0.003 or something. Yeah. And under Draghi is minus 0.6. But I wouldn't say it's not that much. By the way, zero real interest rate for savings, I would almost say, but I would say for savings, the only correct way to use saving is savings deposits. That's the only way where savings is a correct technical term. Yeah? And so the zero interest rate for savings deposit is really questioning a core theory of the neoclassicals, because the idea is if you save, you get a positive real interest rate. That's the core inside of the classical interest rate and also the neoclassical interest rate. And this shows, no, if you just save, you get nothing. And that shows that maybe the theory is wrong. And of course, if you just save, if you just keep your money on a bank account, there's no value for society. Therefore, you get nothing. But so I think it's, by the way, quite nice empirical evidence against this core theory, the saver gets a real interest rate for his saving. No, he gets nothing. Because it's not productive for the society. Anyhow, but for the German saver, you can say he was always, was never a good time for him, and Draghi hasn't changed it. And I can also, from a Keynesian theory, I think you wrote it quite a long time ago, that he's just shifting the deposits from one sector to another sector, and for the shifting of deposits, you don't get anything. It's not the banks, whether a company owns the deposit or a private saver holds the deposit is the same thing for the bank. It doesn't matter. And I think that's what most people don't realize. Okay, but then you can say, well, the government, if people hold government bonds, then in the past they got huge returns. But here you do not only have to take into account inflation, the real rate, but you also have to take into account that, at least in Germany, the government suffers from money illusion, which means in the high inflation area period, you got maybe 10% interest rate. You could say, nice, 10% is a lot of money, better than what we have now. But the government said, okay, this 10% interest rate, we tax it at that time with 50%. So from your 10%, only 5% were left. And then you had 6 or 7% inflation, and then you deduct the 6 or 7% inflation from your 5% net after tax interest rate, and then you get also these negative interest rates. So it's also not such a specific, unique situation that people don't get positive returns on their government bonds. And I always say, so if people complain about, say, this Draghi, he's destroying our pension systems and the poor German savers, you can say, okay, if the German government dislikes this, they can change it. The German government can issue, the German government can issue bonds with a positive interest rate, specially dedicated for pension savings. So the German, nobody prevents the German government from issuing these special bonds with a positive interest rate, because the distribution that takes place with a low interest rate is not from German savers to Italian someones, it's a distribution from the German saver to the German government. That's the distribution that takes place. It's a completely wrong story that with these low interest rates we are supporting Italians. No, it's the German government that is benefiting from that, and if they want to reverse this distribution, they can say, okay, for savers, for their retirement, they get special bonds, 2% positive nominal rate. Nobody prevents them from that. So it's also unfair to criticize Draghi for that. Well, another argument is that the low interest rates are destroying the banks because the interest rates margins are going declining, and so the German banks have a hard time. And here, first of all, one can definitively say the problems of Deutsche Bank have nothing to do with the ECB's interest rate policy, I would say. So I think the bad shape of German banks cannot be in general attributed to Draghi. And the other banks, it's quite interesting. So if you take if you look at the interest rate margin of German banks, so the interest revenues related to total assets and their interest rate expenses, the fascinating thing, the interest rate margin is almost constant. So this decline from relatively high to relatively low interest, it's a kind of parallel shift in both curves. It's nothing. The Bundesbank tries to change it a little bit, the scale, so that you can see a little bit, but it's more or less 1%, 1.1 or 1.0. So even if it makes the scale a little bit different, it looks not so. So this is also not such a good thing. And so let me end up in one thing. When Germany, we have this debate, was the euro good or bad for us? So I think one chart, which I very like, is the right one, which shows the real effective exchange rate of Germany vis-à-vis all countries, vis-à-vis euro area countries and other industrialized countries. And the interesting thing is, in this chart, which also starts in 1961, you can see until the euro, these three curves were more or less in parallel, or were more or less with the same swings. So, and the interesting thing is, with the euro, suddenly the euro area exchange rate remained constant, of course, and then the blue line, which is all countries, did no longer follow the gray line. So Germany was, so to say, supported from the swings of exchange rate changes vis-à-vis the dollar, the pound sterling, everything else. So you can really nicely see, I would say, the protective effect of the euro on German competitiveness. So that this blue line was also more or less getting flat. And so it's really astonishing if people in Germany say today we have no benefit from it. Another thing, also another counterfactual, is Switzerland, where the Swiss National Bank is, like many Germans like it, trying to have its own currency in a very globalized financial world. You can see it's very difficult for them to stabilize the exchange rate, and the price is high. So the Swiss National Bank has now increased their foreign exchange reserves from about $200 billion to about $800 billion. So it's huge. Only with huge foreign exchange interventions, the Swiss National Bank had been able to do this. Yeah? And if you take this, so it's for Switzerland alone, it's $800 billion, so it's almost the target balances of Hans Werner Sinn. Yeah? Only for preserving somehow the exchange rate of Switzerland, which is still too high for that country. So, and then final thing. So if Germans complain about the negative interest rates, it's especially unfair because the key to the door to a world with positive interest rates is in German hands. Why? Because if you want higher inflation in the euro area, you need higher unit labor costs in Germany. Of course, unit labor costs are the main driver of inflation, and you can see in the past, and you can see the past, so the German unit labor costs were below the 1.9 ECB inflation target, which you can translate somehow into unit labor costs, and only the very end a little bit went a little bit above. And if you take from 2010 to 2019, more or less German unit labor costs were in line with the ECB's 1.9%. But that's not good, because in order for the average to reach this 1.9%, the country with the strongest economy would need 1 percentage point plus at least. Yeah? And so with this policy, and of course the other countries, what can they do? They have to remain below. And in the end, unit labor costs in the Eurozone, of course, do not reach 1.9. And if unit labor costs are roughly 1, you get an inflation rate of roughly 1. That's as easy. Yeah, and so the key to the problems is in Germany. We could also add fiscal policy with a more expansionary fiscal policy in the last few years. Yeah, we could have done more in Germany. Why do we have a surplus since years? Yeah, so again, we have the key in our hands. We don't use it, and therefore it's completely unfair to blame the ECB for doing these things. And so let me wrap it up. So I think the ECB has fulfilled its mandate. So that was fine. The ECB in the first 10 years made huge mistakes. At the time when the Germans still loved the ECB, I think the ECB made terrible things, and the same thing in the financial crisis. Draghi did an excellent job in my view, and yeah, the German complaints are not well-founded. We don't have any problems in the financial sector, and in addition, we have the key for the exit from negative interest rates. Thank you.